Okay, thanks for the introduction. My name is Hao Li. I started at USC 1 year ago in the field of computer science. And more specifically, I'm working at the intersection between computer graphics and computer vision, right? And a nice definition of that is in computer graphics, right? You all know it from movies, from computer animation, computer games. Basically, the aim is you tell a story and you reproduce like visually compelling images. And in the field of computer vision, you're given the image and you try to tell a story out of it. So it's like trying to couple both worlds, physical and digital worlds, right? Okay, so you know, we've seen all day, we live in a very, very exciting times. 2014 is possibly the year of immersive technologies. And after a recent survey, over 72% of the people would actually like to spend their money, consumers would like to spend their money on immersive technologies rather than on material items. So what does it mean, and what are the challenges, and what are we looking ahead? What is basically the future vision? The future vision is could be possibly be visualized as follows, is the holodeck, right? This is the grand, the ultimate dream of what we would like to achieve in computer graphics. Suppose you live in the matrix, you can live an alternate reality, something that isn't physically plausible. So that's something that we're trying to look for. And the reason why this is not just science fiction or just some visual effects in a movie is that nowadays there is the democratization of immersive technologies. Well, let's start with Oculus Rift, right? So it's an interface helmet display that allows you to see into the digital world. And you know, virtual reality existed for a while and has never been able to take off. And the reason, or one possible reason why it's happening right now is because graphics performance is at the stage where you can create realistic imagery in real time. So that's the big difference between what you see in special effects and computer games. This is basically some footages of a game, and it's being computed in real time, right? So even this level has been achieved. So the problem, the question is computer graphics solved? Almost, right? So there's one part that isn't. And that part is basically, how do we get the digital content? Creating a digital content requires you to have a full computer graphics pipeline, such as a game company or a VFX studio, but it's impossible for consumers to reproduce what they're thinking. And also, it's still very costly, right? So we want to make this thing easier. And one way is to do 3D scanning. And in order to do 3D scanning, all we need is we can use computer vision algorithms. This is here called the multi-view stereo setup. Put a lot of cameras, put a person in between, take one shot, and you automatically create this high-quality three-dimensional model without requiring to have an artist, a digital sculptor, creating it. So we can do the same thing not only for the appearance of people, but also with motion capture, right? So this is an established technology. Here's a state-of-the-art one where we're basically capturing the human facial performance and also the body performances. And in addition to that, you're retargeting it onto a CG creature. So everything on the right is created through CG, right? So there's ways to make these things to capture shape, and geometry, and motion from the physical world. So you can bring that there. However, it still requires a lot of equipment and also still manual input. So the question is, can we do these things much more automatic? And the grand challenge is to use the best camera in the world, your iPhone. So suppose you can just take a video of someone doing some performances and automatically retarget this onto a digital character or analyze its motion and just trying to have a computer understand that. And that's very difficult because this is what people in computer vision have been struggling for years. And the question is, what would be the right sensor to solve this problem? How can we make these things easier? So a few years ago, we started looking into this problem, and one thing that was way before something called Microsoft Kinect came out is a sensor that actually sees 3D, right? So it basically sees the world as not only colored images, but it's a range sensor, something that has a point cloud of the physical world. So what does it mean? It means that a lot of these very difficult to solve computer vision problems can be turned into a much more efficient numerical or geometric problem. So those kind of things are much easier to solve. So we can capture much more than human bodies. Here is a high-end acquisition system from USC ICT called LightStage 6 from pull the BevEx group, and using this gigantic dome, you can capture not only poses of people, but also cloth deformations, right? So you have all this kind of information. So one of the questions here is, what do you actually do with this data? This data is just pure raw data and doesn't contain much more information. And the other question is, why is this important? Because Microsoft made the first move of putting these kind of devices into an entertainment system, into the Xbox. So every Xbox nowadays is equipped with a 3D camera that doesn't only just see the pose of a person, but actually sees the world in 3D. And we're going to experience much more of that soon, right? So the first step was to bring these things into your living room, into your entertainment systems. They will happen in tablet devices. This is the only way to have a reliable way to locate yourself in the physical world, to bring digital content into your devices, such as for augmented reality. We just saw a wonderful example from Alex. And of course, how do we interact with the computer, right? So the new interfaces, more natural interfaces, could be possible if we have those kind of sensors in the laptop. So next year, you'll have depth sensors inside Intel laptops and also Intel tablet devices. But in the future, we'll possibly have them also in our mobile phones. This is a company called Pelican Imaging from the Bay Area. And basically, what they're building is a 3D camera that is low-powered and works on a mobile phone. And this is interesting because it's a concept video where they're trying to, you know, take a video of someone and try to reconstruct a human body. But here at USC, we actually created the software actually for that already. So we already have the algorithm to process this information I'll show you next. Okay, so what is my research about? My research is about using this kind of hardware that produces three-dimensional information. And as I said before, they solve very difficult computer vision problems with much easier space, in the space of geometry and numerical optimization. So basically, my input is these kind of data of humans. And the question is, what can we do with it? Well, you can do two things. First of all, you can solve computer graphics problems. You can make things look much more realistic. Instead of having an artist trying to recreate the physical world, it computes it for you. It measures for you. Once you have that information, the next thing you can do with that is you can analyze what the human is doing. Imagine you can have a computer understand what the person is doing, not only through artificial intelligence, but by being able to collect a lot of data. There was this question, what is big data before? Well, one other perspective of it is basically you collect a lot of data, you try to mimic what a person would be able to behave if you have such data, and you would basically use some form of data-driven machine learning. And what people are doing here, even here at NYU, is showing the fact that if you have so much data, you can solve a lot of very difficult problems that are easy for humans to do, such as recognition. Okay, so what do we need? What are the ingredients for such things? I'd just like to show you a little hint on what this kind of research is about. So on the left, what you see is like an acquisition, an input of a hand, and on the right, you have a complete hand model. The question is, how do you transfer this incomplete data into this fully complete hand model? Well, first of all, you need to solve something called a correspondence problem, and most of the computational problems reduce to this one. So a lot of computer vision problems. So let's have a look at when you have two of them. So for the computer, for the human, it's very easy to recognize. We recognize these are all scans from the hand, where the index finger is pointing to, but the computer has no knowledge of it. To the computer, it's just a set of three-dimensional unstructured point clouds. So we're mapping this into a geometric problem where we can formulate everything as an energy minimization that basically allows you to have one thing warp onto the other. And by warping onto the other between two different data, we can transfer information between geometries that are easy for a human to recognize but not for a computer. So let's have a look at what we can do with it. Suppose you have one device computational model, that's the green one, that's a full complete human body, and I take a scan of another person. Even from this completely extreme pose, I can compute such warping automatically. There is no human telling it where to go. But just by formulating this very difficult artificial intelligence problem into a geometric problem, I can warp one scan to another. So this is closely related to the mapping of brains. So these are similar algorithms that we're doing, but just applied into a more graphics domain, right? So you can extract automatically semantics up about the shape of people. If you collect a full statistics of just 2,000 people, you can actually even understand, extract information such as what is the probability of the age of the person, the BMI, et cetera, et cetera. So you can extract all these type of information. And obviously, people in the clothing industry, retail industry, are very interested in that because you have a way to easily extract people's sizes and also so that we can have customized ways to design clothing for you, right? So these are obvious applications. However, for these type of application, you need to collect a lot of data. And what is a good way to collect data if you give something back to the people? And one thing that was also inspired by the application we were showing before with 3D printing is maybe we just give people away a 3D figurine. And also, this is an inspiration from a Japanese artist. So basically, the idea here is with 3D scanning and 3D printing technology, can we give, can we reproduce a, sort of like a next generation 3D photograph? So the 3D scanning process traditionally is very, not very elegant. You need a person sitting there, Brazilian player, well, that was before the World Cup, scanning him, you need an operator holding this laptop. It's very, very heavy. It's not very elegant solution. The question is, if someone wants to take a picture of himself, they probably want to take a selfie, right? So what is the right way to solve that? Well, we came up with a different approach where we take the cheapest possible 3D camera, $100 Kinect, put it there, and inside your living room, without any complicated lighting condition, we use computer vision algorithms to data-driven algorithms, to be more concrete. We basically just move around the system freely. It captures all the different regions of you, the geometries of your body, and pieces everything together. What you get in the end is this high-quality three-dimensional model that takes all the different parts again and combines them together. And you also get, it's even textured, right? So it's removing the lighting information automatically. So these things work fairly well. So we are not even including any priors about human bodies. So we can scan people in clothing, different poses, even multiple people are possible. But it's not only good for 3D printing, right? One thing you can also do with this is to create a digital avatar. So here's a collaboration with USC ICT with Ari Shapiro's group, and I think he's giving a demonstration of this technology outside. And what you can do is basically you scan your body, and you can automatically create a digital virtual avatar of yourself instantly. There's no human modeling in the loop, right? So given this, you can think of possibly having the next personalized games, right? So you can have yourself play a computer game, or I don't know, it can be very interesting to even have a social impact for social media. So I mean, there's a reason why Facebook probably spent $2 billion in buying Oculus VR. Faces, right? Faces tells a lot about us. This is basically our primary biometric feature, and that's how we recognize each other and also communicate with each other. And faces in the field of computer graphics are very interesting. There are very, very little movies with realistic facial CG faces, right? Where you cannot distinguish between physical and digital. So one of the best examples is probably the curious case of Benjamin Button. But what you may not know is it took 3 weeks for just only 10 seconds of animation. But what we'd like to do is basically do the same thing in real time without markers, without all these things for consumers. So I'd like to show you a quick demonstration of our latest facial performance capture technology. So can we switch the screen? Thank you. So this technology basically uses a 3D camera, and it's loading right now. Okay, so you can basically see myself. So this is an augmented reality application, right? So the gray guy is basically my face that is being tracked in real time, so it's 3D, right? And the great thing about this is that it's not only tracking the face, but it's also trying to understand what is face and what isn't. So you can clearly see that my hair, when it's occluding, it recognizes on the fly that it's not my hair. Right? So this is like one new feature we're trying to include. And now the obvious fun things you can do with it is you can just turn your head into a monkey. All right, thank you. Can we switch back? All right. So that was a fun demo. But obviously, we're not there yet, right? We want to actually go beyond. This is one of the most realistic real-time facial animations that have been captured. Ari Shapiro is actually somewhere here, or there. We have the physical one and the digital one on the screen. So this project has been called Digital Ira. And one thing we'd like to do is to explore the opportunity of using performance capture and reproduce this kind of animation in real time as well, right? So these are one of the next step goals. Here's an open problem. We're not there yet in order to create something that's completely realistic. And so this is actually not CG, this is real. But this is, of course, one of the next challenges that we're trying to attempt. One last thing, hair. Hair is a thing that in computer graphics is extremely difficult to not only generate, but also to simulate, right? So to create the animation. So one thing we've been looking at is how can we actually automatically create hair as well? I mean, it's part of the human body. And the problem with hair, as opposed to the human body, is that human bodies all have the same anatomy. And basically, hair could have a much wider variation. So you need a data-driven approach for that. So one thing we've been doing is we basically use a multi-view stereo capture system, can capture hair, and by introducing three very important components, the appearance, the geometry, and the physics of it, and by combining all these different priors, we can generate high-quality hair fully automatically, right? This is just through computer vision. Just by looking at the images, it can create these high-fidelity hair geometries. Our next step, obviously, is to go away from using a high-end capture environment. We want to just use something like a Kinect, so that someday we can capture hair and entire human bodies with just a cell phone. We've succeeded in that, so this is something we just we're going to publish in well, it's already published, but we're going to present at SIGGRAPH. Basically, it's a way to capture hair with just a single Kinect, and we can even capture braided hairs, right? So things where the topology is highly complex and with a lot of intertwined hair. So you've seen a lot of really fun applications in the entertainment industry, in the consumer level, but also all this 3D capture and dynamic shape reconstruction also impacts science. So I've collaborated with people from biology, from evolutionary biology, to understand basically the cracking of the skin of crocodiles, right? So they are actually an they're actually a physical process and not a genetical one. I've collaborated with a cardiologist on the problem of trying to figure out the connection between cardiac surface mechanics and electrophysiology through 3D scanning. So they actually built a mini structural light scanner in order to capture a high resolution beating of the heart and to find a markerless tracking. And the last example is one I'm really proud of, is that we actually use a similar system to a Kinect in order to capture the body surface measurement, the body deformations, in order to infer where tumors are in real time, so that in real time we can basically turn on and off the radiation in order to know, well, to have a much more accurate radiation treatment. All right, so to conclude, the future is going 3D. There's a very similar pipeline in a 2D world, right? We take our cell phone images, we have Instagram, we have Photoshop, and we have 2D printers. In the 3D world, we have the equivalent. We have 3D sensors that will soon be deployed in virtually every electronic device. We are working on the geometry processing tools to make the shapes, the information much better, and also to recover much more information. And the final stage is also we can reproduce those digital content back into the physical world. But I think this is not it. What's really important is that right now, I think we really have a chance to give machines a human-scale understanding of space and motion. Thank you very much.